Good morning. Welcome to Merigold Baptist Church. Turn to hymn number 29, our call to worship. How majestic is your name? We'll sing it through twice as it's written. Let's stand together as we sing. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, we praise your name. Oh Lord, we magnify your name, Prince of Majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh Lord, we praise your name. Oh Lord, we magnify your name, Prince of Peace. Thank you. You may be seated.
Good morning. Let me just start off by saying, like Dorothy Gale once said, there's no place like home. It is so good to be back with y'all this morning after being in New Orleans for the Southern Baptist Convention last week. I'm going to give an update on that later on, but we just wanted to say thank you for sending Ashton and I to represent Merigold. It was a good week, but like you said, it's good to be home. Happy Father's Day to all of our fathers who are here. We thank you for what you do for your families, for the church. We love you, and we hope you'll have a great Father's Day today. With that said, there is no Bible study tonight at 5 p.m., so please make note of that. And then next Sunday, immediately following the morning worship service, we are going to have a potluck after church, and then y'all, the church, are graciously throwing us a baby shower. So well, thank you in advance for that, and then I know it's going to be a great time celebrating Spencer next week. But wanted to invite everyone to that next Sunday morning. And then finally, if you'd like a copy of this week's prayer list, you can pick one up in the back of the sanctuary. But with that said, let's pray together and we will continue on with our time of worship. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you for everything you've done. God, every attribute, every characteristic you have is good. It is holy. It's perfect. God, and we thank you for those things. Father, we recognize that we are lost people. God, we are sinful people who need a Savior. God, and we thank you that you sent Jesus Christ to do just that. God, that without Jesus Christ, there's no hope for us, Father. And we thank you that you loved us enough that you sent Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. Father, I pray right now as we continue on with this time of service, God, I pray that everything that is said, everything that's saying, everything that is done here this morning would be for your honor and your glory alone, in accordance with your will, God, because that's why we are here. We are here to worship you and give you the praise and glory and honor that you deserve. And we want everything that you want to happen this morning, Father. So let your will be done, not ours. We say these things and we pray these things in your holy, precious name. Amen.
It is Father's Day, and we're going to be singing hymns about Father's Day. And I do know we have at least one out-of-town guest. Spunky, good to see you, my friend. You're here, I know, for your dad today. And Angie, of course, is here, but she's local. And Spunky, your son is with you? Yes, good. But anyway, we love your dad, and I think you know that. I think y'all's family knows that. But welcome this morning. Let's sing hymn number 8. Hymn number 8, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God. We'll sing the first, second, and last stanzas. Number 43, This Is My Father's World. And we'll sing all three stanzas.
This is my father's world, and to and round me rings the music of the spheres. This is my father's world. I rest me in the fold of rocks and trees, of skies and seas. His hand the wonders wrought. This is my father's world. The birds their carols raise, the morning like the sure. us. He speaks to me everywhere. This is my Father's world. Oh, let me never forget that through the wrong seems all so strong.
Faith of our fathers. We'll sing all three stanzas. Get you a while ago. I know you're out of town guest here for your father too, but you're here so much. We just consider you family. But thank you for being here. Thank you. by special request, Rhonda, a hymn that, according to my paper, says copyright 1954. It's but it's also later copyrighted in 1969. A song I loved growing up is simply entitled He.
He can turn the tides and calm the angry sea. He alone decides who writes a symphony. He lights every star that makes our darkness bright. He keeps watch all through each long and lonely night. He still finds a time to hear a child's first prayer. Saint or sinner, call and always find him it makes him sad to see the way we live. He'll always can grant a wish or make a dream come true. He can paint the clouds and turn the gray to blue. He alone knows where to find the rainbow's end. He alone can see what lies beyond the bend. He can touch a tree and turn the leaves to gold. Knows every lie that you and I have told. Though it makes him sad to see the way we live, he'll always say,
aren't you thankful that if you're a child of God, that you are forgiven by that same God from the sin that separates us from Him? Amen. Thank you, David. Well, this morning, it's going to be a little bit different than usual, but I do still encourage you to turn with me in your Bibles this morning to the book of Matthew chapter 5, verses 10 through 12. Matthew 5, 10 through 12, and we're going to get to those verses in just a little bit. But my original plan was to do this next Sunday night during Bible study, but I wanted everyone to have a chance to hear the things that happened last week at the convention. And the reason why I do this is simple. It's the biblical model of when you go on a trip, you come back to your church and give a report on what happened. It's what Paul did every single time he went on one of his missionary journeys. He would go back to the church in Antioch that sent him out, and he would give a report on what happened. And so this is why we're taking this morning, and I want to give everyone an update on the SBC. But before we jump into this, I just want to say again, thank you for allowing Ash and I to go. We had a great time, something that I've wanted to experience for the last few years, and I finally got to. So without y'all generosity in sending us, we wouldn't have been able to do that. So thank you so much. But with that said, let's dive into what happened. And if you're a note taker, I encourage you to take notes on some of the statistics and verses that we're going to be jumping into in just a second. But I want to start off talking about the pastor's conference. On Sunday night and Monday all day were the first two unofficial days of the convention. Every year there is a conference for pastors and their wives to go to. And this year's theme of the conference was Character Matters in Ministry, Beatitudes of a Pastor. Now, worship was led by a man named Travis Cottrell. And all in total, there were 17 pastors who spoke at these meetings. Eight preached through the Beatitudes in Matthew 5, and nine gave 10-minute sermonettes through each one of the fruit of the Spirit. Now, Monday night, Pastor H.B. Charles from Jacksonville, Florida, preached through Matthew 5, 10 through 12, the verses on persecution. And this is the message that really stuck with me, and I want to give you some of the things that he said. And before we get into that, here are the verses. Here are those verses. Jesus says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." Brother H.B. reminded us that when a Christian is persecuted by the world, and this is something that we all need to remember, Jesus doesn't tell him or her that they will be, could be, or might be blessed by God for that persecution. Jesus tells us that they are blessed, present tense. Whenever the church persecutes us for standing firm on the truth of Scripture, the world is not going to like it. And we are always going to get some sort of backlash from the world for standing on the truth of God. But that backlash is a good thing. Because when we get backlash and pushback and persecution from the world, it means that we are standing with God. And that is always where we want to be as Christians. So next I want to get into the annual meetings, Tuesday and Wednesday. These were the main sessions of the meetings this year. And the theme was serving the Lord and serving others. This was when Tuesday morning is when the Southern Baptist Church entities were given chances to give their reports. And Tuesday morning, the International Mission Board and the North American Mission Board were able to give their reports. And I want us to focus in on these stats, because these statistics, these numbers should absolutely break our hearts. According to the North American Mission Board, there are 278,300,000 people in the United States, Canada, and Mexico who are currently lost. That is 74% of North America does not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. To make that number even more shocking, the International Mission Board stood up and gave their report. There are 3,072 people groups around the world who have never been engaged with the gospel at all, which makes up for 3.37 billion people. 42% of the entire world's population has never heard the gospel, has never had a chance to repent of their sin and come to faith in Jesus Christ. When we say that everyone in the world needs the gospel, it is absolutely true. And almost half of the world has never heard it. To make matters even worse than that, if I can, over 173,000 people die every single day without having heard the gospel. We, as the universal church, and we as the local church here at Merigold Baptist, have not only a job, but a responsibility to reach people with the truth of the gospel. We have a responsibility given to us by God, the great commission, not the great suggestion, to reach people for Jesus. He has given us the message of the gospel, and we are to in turn give it to the world. People everywhere are dying without the knowledge that there is a God who loves them, a God who wants to save them from their sin. People don't realize there is a God who sent His only Son, Jesus, to the earth that He created, to be born of a virgin, live a perfect life, and die on a cross, because He is the only one who could save them from their sin. That He was the only one who could allow us to go to heaven and be with God instead of being punished in hell for the bad things that we all do. 173,000 people every single day. Y'all, we have a job to do, and it is important that we do it. But there is hope for those people around the world. One of the coolest parts of the entire convention took place on Tuesday morning. It was the International Mission Board's Mission Sending Celebration. We got to see 79 missionaries commissioned to 31 different countries around the world to share the hope of the gospel. We got to hear about who they are, got to hear about their families, some a little bit about where they're going, but there were some who, as they were sharing their names, their testimonies, their faces were completely blacked out. They were behind a screen because they were going to places so dangerous, so hostile to God and the gospel, that they had to be kept anonymous for fear of their lives. Also, we didn't know this as a church, and I'm honestly not sure how many people did know this, but the International Mission Board, we found out, assigns every single Southern Baptist church a missionary to pray for, to support. I reached out to the IMB. They didn't have the file with them, but hopefully the next couple weeks I will be able to find out who our missionary is here at Merigold, who the IMB has assigned to us to help, to pray for, to support. And so hopefully in the next few weeks I can have that information, and I will gladly pass it on to you guys. But that was Tuesday morning. Tuesday afternoon was the session that carried the most publicity with it. That afternoon was the presidential election for the convention and a time of miscellaneous business. Dr. Bart Barber, who's the pastor at First Baptist Farmersville, Texas, was reelected as the president, so he will have one more year, one more term as president of the convention. But the presidential election wasn't what got all the headlines. It was the miscellaneous business time. During this time, there were three major votes that happened. And these were the ones I mentioned I ask everyone to pray for in emails and on Facebook. Three churches: Saddleback Community Church, Fern Creek Baptist Church, and Freedom Baptist Church had all been disfellowshipped from the Southern Baptist Convention back in February. And they appealed their decision. They appealed the executive committee's decision. And the executive committee left it up to the messengers, those who were there for the convention, all 12,073 of us, to determine whether or not they were going to be allowed back into fellowship or they would remain outside of our convention. Now, Saddleback, founded by Rick Warren, and Fern Creek Baptist had been disfellowshipped because they had female pastors on their staff. And Freedom Baptist was disfellowshipped because they had knowingly been guilty. They had knowingly called a man who had been guilty of sexual abuse as their pastor. The messengers voted to uphold all three fellowships by at least 88%. And this is where I want to make very clear, because this was something that has been all over the news, all over everywhere you turn lately, has been this topic. This is where I want to make sure that we are very clear on where we as a convention stand and where we as a church stand. The Apostle Paul wrote to his protege Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 12 and 13. I do not permit a woman to teach or exercise authority over a man. Rather, she is to remain quiet. For Adam was created first, and then Eve. Women have a very specific and insanely important role given to them by God. Their role is no more important than a man's role, and vice versa. But God is very, very clear on where the hierarchy of the church stands. Holding teaching authority over a man within the church is not one of the roles that God gave to women. And oftentimes you will hear, well, these were Paul's words. Paul says, I don't do this or I don't do that. But it's important for us to remember, like Dr. Albert Moeller once said, Christians need to remember, given the doctrine of divine inspiration of Scripture, that when Paul condemns something, the Holy Spirit condemns it as well. When we cite Paul, we cite the Holy Spirit. God is a God of order. He created men first and then women. He created men to be the leaders in the home, the church, and in society. And when women take on the roles they were not given, it throws that order into chaos. And when voting on these churches to be disfellowshipped from the Southern Baptist Convention, the messengers chose to stand on the truth of Scripture. It was either stand on Scripture or stand with a cultural trend. And our convention did the right thing. Wednesday was a day of reports and votes and more convention business. And that morning, an amendment was brought forth to the messengers to amend the Baptist Faith and Message 2000, which is our convention's statement of faith and belief, that specifically states the role of pastor, elder, and overseer be limited to men, according to Scripture. And this vote passed overwhelmingly. Wednesday afternoon, each of the seminary presidents spoke, and then representatives from Indianapolis, Indiana, which is where the convention next year is going to be, prayed and closed us out. So it was a great time. It was a great few days. These are just some of the highlights and stats that happened in New Orleans. Again, want to thank everyone for sending Ashton and I to go. God was absolutely glorified in the things that happened in New Orleans. But I would be irresponsible if I didn't say this. Earlier, we mentioned all of the people in North America, around the world, who do not have a relationship with Jesus Christ. It's possible that there are some here or some watching online who are in those numbers. If you have never come to faith in Jesus Christ for salvation, if you have never turned from your sin in repentance and put your entire faith, belief, trust in Jesus Christ as the only one who can save, it is not too late to do so. I beg you, come to Jesus Christ before it is too wait, right here and right now, you can have your sin forgiven by God. In just a second, we're going to have a time of invitation. And if that's you, there's nothing more that I would like to do on this Father's Day than to allow you to be adopted by a Father who loves you, a holy, eternal Father who loves you. If you need prayer for anything at all, I would love to pray with you for whatever it is. If you feel the Lord leading you to join our church family, I would love to talk about that with you more. But whatever it is, whatever God is laying on our hearts to do right here and right now, let's be obedient to Him. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy towards us. God, most importantly, we thank you for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for the salvation that we have through Him and through Him alone. Father, I thank you for what happened in New Orleans. God, even though it was a sad thing to do, because that means that other brothers and sisters do not stand on your truth, I thank you that our convention stood firm on your word. God, we pray for those who have been disfellowshipped. We pray for their hearts. We pray for their repentance. Father, may they see your truth from your word as clearly as you've said it. Father, during this time of invitation, I pray that if there's anyone here who does not know you as the Lord and Savior of their life, as their eternal, holy Father, I pray that today they would be adopted into your family. I pray they would leave behind their sin and run toward you as hard and as fast as they possibly can. Father, we give this time of invitation over to you now. God, let us be obedient to whatever it is you are calling us to do right here and right now. We thank you again for everything you've done for us, Father. And we love you with everything we are. We say these things and pray these things in your holy and precious name. Amen.
Our hymn of invitation is number 275, I Surrender All. Let's stand together as we sing.
Thank you, everyone. At this time, please be seated, and I'd like to recognize Connie and Sandy.
The children would like to give y'all something for Father's Day. Our lesson today was on fathers. Of course, our first father being God, our Father. Y'all be surprised at the examples they gave of y'all as fathers and grandfathers. I want to say grandfathers aren't grandfathers. They're supposed to, but they're the top thing. But if your father raised your hand, your grandfather raised your hand. They're going to come see you. Anybody that doesn't have one, raise your hand. Go back in there, see? Like, raise your hand high. We're little folks. Go see the hands. Okay. Has everybody got one now? Okay, children, what do you say? Happy
Father's Day.
Good job. I go find your father. Oh, and a shout out to Say-Say. Say-Say is always our artist and makes all our cool things. We do appreciate her. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, ladies, and thank you, children, for that recognition. With that said, a reminder, no Bible study tonight, but at this time, let's pray, and we will be dismissed. JP, would you pray us out, please, brother?